We talked about an estimate like this whenever whatever I'm going to talk about now, but I can exhibit better bias variance trade-off with this estimate. That's something I'm going to talk about. If you want to recall, the oracle that we have been looking at is something like this. The oracle is having the correct, you know, having a bias which scales with the square of a parameter delta square, and variance that go, you know, is inversely proportional to delta. And that just meant that, you know, we even had an information theoretic lower bound yesterday for the convex case, which was 1 by n power 1 by 3. So, if you have a trade-off like this, even in information, in a minimax sense, the best rate you can expect is 1 by n power 1 by 3. And the lower bounds, the asymptotic convergence rates, all of them have been saying a rate like 1 by n power 1 by 3. Now, if I can, you know, come up with a different, slightly, you know, clever analysis or refined analysis where this variance scales not inversely but directly with, say, delta or delta square, but there will be some loss. So, the bias will not scale with, you know, bias will be not like C1 delta square, but it will be C1 delta. So, I am going to construct an oracle using a simultaneous perturbation trick again, where the bias and variance is, you know, managed better. Okay. Okay, so I'm going to specify the oracle. Okay, so this business, as I said, started with yesterday I gave Kotkovnik and Kolchitsky. I think 72 or something. Then it was reinvented by Nestrov and okay. So the idea is you take your function, okay, and then you convolve with the Gaussian density, okay, and then that gives you a smooth function, and that has better properties. You work with this smooth. That's the smooth functional. Kotkovnik Kolchitsky called it the smooth functional. And then Nestrov calls it Gaussian smoothing, but it's still a simultaneous perturbation trick. So with this, okay, let me call this oracle O1 prime. This is a Gaussian smoothing oracle. Okay, there's still some function f that the environment fixes. Okay, and you pass a x comma delta. And you get a random element g, and you are the algorithm. Okay, but this oracle is a little better because of the following bias variance trade-off. Okay, so what it takes the same input x comma delta. There's still a perturbation parameter or a perturbation constant delta. Okay, and it outputs a random element which is the gradient estimate g of x comma psi. And this satisfies the following properties. Note, it's delta, not delta square. Okay. And variance. Now, here is where the important twist comes. There is some other constant, okay. I can specify all of these constants for you. C1 equals, we are assuming L smooth functions. Where, I mean, if you assume noisy evaluations, this is a bound on the variance and B is a bound probably on the gradient. Yeah, so this is the twist. Okay, there's no trade-off, but you know, bias is as not as low as before. Not as, there's no trade-off really. Yes, in some sense, there's no trade-off. And this leads to 1 by square root n rates, even with zeroth order. So this is still a zeroth order thing. Okay, you can construct an oracle using zeroth order information. Okay, and I'm going to say how this oracle is constructed. I'm going to show only this. Now, once you see this, I think this can be done. Okay, I'll just, you just have to look up Nesterov's paper. Okay, yeah, I think delta has to be greater than zero to make up a valid gradient estimate. Yeah, yeah, probably you can make it as small, but how much, I don't know. In theory, it doesn't, but doesn't matter really. Yeah. But yeah. Okay, I can show you. Maybe we can discover because this is an oracle I just picked up in January. Yeah. No, you can't pick zero because you won't get a gradient estimate. You don't have gradient still. So I'm not saying you don't see it as a black box. I'll tell you how this Gaussian smoothing is done. Okay. I'll tell you how this Gaussian smoothing is done. You still have a zeroth order information only. You have a box. Think of this. This box is made up of some other box which is giving you noisy function measurements. Okay. And so you have to make up your gradients. The gradients are not there. So if you make delta equal 0, I don't think you get any gradients. Yeah. Delta has to be greater than 0. You don't get gradients at all. Yeah. Very small. Anyway, you take even the other case, you take delta down to 0. You can, it doesn't seem to change here. I'm just saying you can take delta down to 0. At what rate, I don't know. But yeah. You can take it down. You remember this estimate here, yesterday I was talking about, okay. And now if you choose u and v to be the same, okay, I mean coming from the same distribution, and that's what I'm going to talk about. Okay, this is the thing I'm going to talk about. For this, using Taylor expansion, the usual technique, I can come up with a order of C1 delta square comma C2 by delta square oracle. But using a slightly different analysis from that Nesterov paper, I can come up with this new oracle. Okay. It's the same zeroth order. It's the same estimate. The estimate is not new. It's still a simultaneous perturbation estimate. Okay. Where u is like that, delta is there. Yeah. If you take very small delta, that goes into the estimate. There is. Yeah, somewhere. What is v? V is delta. V has u by delta. So there's a 1 by delta there. Okay. And that would cause anywhere, which is notes. Yeah. So I will show how this, at least the first one, how we can make up this using slightly different. So the point is, instead of going through a Taylor expansion, you can take a slightly different route where you are seeing this estimate as, you know, you are making up a new function where you are convolving your objective with a Gaussian density, okay, and you are making some smooth function out of it and then taking the gradient of that. That's the trick, which is slightly different analysis to what we have. I mean, assume that the underlying, you know, function measurements have some variance bounded by this. Yeah, I think that's what it is. Yeah, so if you made up this gradient, if you made up a box, if you have a box, you pass a x and you get an estimate f of x comma z and expectation of psi square less than equal to square. So the point is, this is still a zeroth order oracle. You are using noisy function evaluations, and that noise parameter should come somewhere. So I'll show the first part. Okay. So we'll start. So again, just recall, you're in the Gaussian smoothing, also called, also known as smooth functional. What is interesting is, okay, so if somebody wants a research idea, if you go to this Katkonic Kulcsics paper, they give like 3 or 4 conditions that any smoothing function has to satisfy. And they are satisfied by the Gaussian density. So you can convolve with that. You can convolve with other, you know, possible candidates. The question is, where will you get same kind of bias variance trade-off? Will you get something better? What you get, that's something that's worth investigating. I'm able to, I mean, any, so that's the smooth functional part. Gaussian smoothing is for a specific instance of smooth functioning. So what you do is you make up this function, I'll call it f delta of x. So all the integrals over R are over x belonging to Rd, okay, I'm not going to write it in here. So I'm going to take this function that you have and do this. Okay, this is my new function, which is a smooth approximation to the objective that I was talking about. Okay. Now let's talk about this. I'm not got to the gradient. Imagine there is some objective function small f, and I'm going to make a small f delta which is smoothening it by convolving with the Gaussian density. Small f is expectation of capital F. If you want to call that, if you have a oracle there, if you take out the noise, if you take expectation with respect to xi of capital F, then you will get small f. Okay. And now I want to write down the gradient of this function in a manageable form. So this is from Nesterov's thing, Nesterov's paper. So if I want to write down this gradient in a manageable form, I'll do a small change of variable which makes life simple. To 1 by delta power d. Okay, I've gone from u to y simply because it's easier to take gradients after this. So x is fixed, okay, x is fixed, that just goes in inside the integral, u is the variable, and I've changed u to y. Okay, I go from u to y, and this is what I would get. Okay, and I want to take I didn't want to write anything, so I'll just say calculating gradient of delta. No, I have delta there. That's the delta. So this is for a given delta. I come up with an approximation. Yeah, you just change the variable from u to y, okay, and then you will get this adjustment. This y, yes, yeah. So when you do that, u will be like, you will get the 2 delta square, not 2, but you will get delta square there. So I'll have to scroll up. So I have delta power d there, the extra 2 will come here. There will be another delta square that comes and sits there. I'll have a y minus x. Sorry, and this is an extra y minus x. And now again, we'll go back. Honestly, I don't know if there's a more easier way to do this, but this change of variable at least makes things simple. I'll go back to x again. I mean, u. Yeah. Okay. This is an estimate of which function, not the objective function. This is an estimate of the gradient of a smooth approximation to the function that you are talking about. You have some function and then you convolve with the Gaussian density and you made up a smooth function and the gradient of that is this. Now I want to show that this is closer to the gradient of f, which is my objective. Okay, that's really the bias part that I was talking about. But before that, I'll just make a minor tweak. So this is an, you know, estimate that's not you know, having just one function value. You can throw in and make it can make a variant of this, and that you can make by observing this 1 by 2 pi power e by 2 delta integral. What you can do is x plus delta u minus f of x. Okay, I'll put the delta here. All I've done is I've done that minus f of x, but why is this a legitimate thing? Because that's just a, you know, mean of a Gaussian vector, which is 0. Okay. Gaussian random variable, the mean is just 0. So if you throw in f of x or any constant, it does not matter. And this usually leads to better gradient estimates than just using this one bit. Okay. That's the reason why we throw in. Like, you know, x is not a variable inside that. Okay. Just a parameter that goes in here. So it just, when you look at that integral without the u, the second one with just f of x, that integral is just 0. That's like u times that. I mean, this is the mean of a Gaussian. We used u times square. Sorry? No, I didn't get your question. What? No, we got the y minus x there, right? If you look at the earlier expression, you got from delta power d, you got delta power d by 2, then you got a y minus x there. Okay, now instead of x, I mean it can be shown. I'm not going to show this. You can also do something like this. I think this is also okay. 1 by 2 pi power delta by 2 integral of x plus delta u. Instead of doing this, you can have balanced estimates. Not going to use this, but this is also fine. Okay. This is also okay. Yeah, instead of throwing f of x, you can throw in the other side. Yeah. Now you want to show something. Okay. Now want to show that f delta of dot is close to gradient of the actual function. Okay. That's what you want to show. You convolved, you did whatever. Okay. This estimator is very much like, this is the simultaneous perturbation estimator, okay? Yeah, so whatever I put it with u and all, it's exactly like this, okay? But the point is, I can do a slightly refined analysis using the fact that it's Gaussian density that I'm playing with. And so now I want to show bound this distance. Okay, this is what I want to show. Okay, and for this, I'm going to for the gradient part, I'm using this part. Okay, I'm using this part. Okay, for the gradient of f delta. And then I'm going to bring in minus mu times f of x comma u Actually, this would be 2 delta. Good. Yeah, now it should be okay. Now, how did this follow? Again, I'm going to throw in something here. So the reason is what we used. So this across pages won't work. Used 1 by 2 pi to d by 2 integral. That's the identity matrix, D dimension. Okay. So I use this to throw in, to handle the last part with the gradient. Okay. So the last part, if you ignore the first two, forget the norm, if you ignore the first two, then the last part is no mu. I'm really sorry. This should be delta. Keep making mistakes. The problem with translation, because I didn't, it's looking at nestraw and then making some compilation with symbols, then I ran into mu because it should be just delta. Okay, so the first two terms should be clear. The first two terms lead to the this, the last term comes from here. Okay, and now the last bit. Last bit, I want to show this. Now I can use smoothness for this part. Okay. I can use the fact that f is say L smooth to bound this, whatever is there, the absolute value, that I can use smoothness. Okay. So I'm going to use less than or equal to. So I better erase this. So start, write the LHS. See, the thing is, you have to do this only once, unless you come up with a new functional for smoothing. You just have to do it only once and get the bias and variance and then play with your algorithm. And that is that once that I am doing now. Again, some green business. We used what? We used the fact that because f is L smooth, f of y minus f of x minus f of x minus x. Okay. So I use this to bound this business, the absolute thing. Okay. You can bound that using the fact that f is L smooth and get this. Okay. And then if I take out these constants, then it's just, you know, Gaussian random vector. I want to find some peak moment or something like that. Okay. And that can be bounded as a function of just the dimension. So you will get this is less than or equal to, what is the final thing? Delta L by 2 into D plus 3 tau 3 by 2. Again, I want some green business. Used what? Used 1 by 2 pi to D by 2 cube. Okay, that's where we went. Okay. This is already enough to handle the bus. Okay. Yeah. The rest is just a noise. Whenever you have noisy evaluations, when you take expectation, the noise is gone. And then it comes down to the difference between the smooth functional that you used, the Gaussian smooth version, minus the actual gradient. Previously, we took the Taylor expansion route, but now you can take a slightly different route and you get this. The important thing is, see, you got a delta here. Okay. Now, not going to do the proof, but you can show the other property also using techniques like this, and you will get the other part. Okay. I didn't want to bore you with a lot of details, but you will get the other part. Let's see if I can share. This part also can be shown. I showed only part A, part B also can be shown. Okay. Using just facts about, you know, Gaussian distributions. Yeah. No, my gradient estimate is just this guy. I mean, the expectation is hidden. My gradient estimate is just going to be, I'll highlight something. Let's say this. You can throw in the noise, but this is my gradient estimate. Okay, just throw in the U also. My gradient estimate is exactly whatever I presented before. All this integration business is like taking expectation. That's like saying that you take the expectation of this estimate and you get some nice properties. When you're making up an estimate, you're not taking expectations. Okay. Yes. Like, yeah. So my estimate is just, let's say this. My estimate is just this. Okay. My estimate is this, where U is that and V is that. Okay. U is this, where this is a d-dimensional Gaussian vector. Okay. Standard normal. And V is that. So this is my estimate. So when I take expectation, the noise goes off. Okay. And whatever I'm left with is a smooth version of the function. And I want to compare it to the actual gradient. That's exactly what I did. That's exactly what I did when I did before. I just gave you the most important piece. I've not written out the full bias to show Oracle, but the rest should be easy to fill. Once I show this, the rest is easy. You know, when I take expectation, the noise goes off. So just, you have to show that whatever function you made up, the smooth version, the gradient of that is close to the gradient of the actual objective. Okay. Yeah. That's shown. The only thing is, if you use this route, you get the bias which scales with delta. Okay. Previously, we used to get delta square. Here you got delta. Okay. This is somewhat weaker, but the variance is not inversely proportional. That proof I'm not going to do, but yeah. Is this clear? So you can make up an oracle like this, and then what happens is, when you do the rate, if you redo the whole, if you do redo the proof, I'm going to just sketch the bound. So, which is like saying that I do xk plus 1 equals xk minus some step size into g of xk comma ik, where this comes from the Gaussian smoothing oracle. Let's call this GS. This is from GS oracle. Previously, I had an oracle which was having a different bias variance trade-off. Here, I can give inputs based on this. Okay. And the bias and variance scale differently now. If you look at this, the bias and variance scale differently with delta. Okay. Now, if you redo that proof, you can get up to some point, which I'll just write down, and you get a better bound by using this. Okay. Yeah. Simply because there's no delta in the denominator. So, you can choose, I'll just make that part apparent. Just two steps I'm going to sketch. So it's the same algorithm. So run one for n iterations, output a random iterate. Output XR picked uniformly at random from x1 until xn. So we have n iterates, we pick one of them. It's the same algorithm except that the input is coming from a different oracle. Okay. Yeah, you have to go through that. Correct. It will give me exactly this. I have put the constant source. It will give me exactly that. Yeah. So this is the new oracle. But this oracle, I have shown that you can construct this oracle by that f delta that I wrote down. Okay. D plus 5 the C2, yeah, maybe, yeah, square, yes, yeah, hopefully, yeah, I don't recall it, yeah. Yeah, so what happens is, it's like, you know, you just work with an oracle. It's like somebody asked me the calculation, it's hard to recall unless you have seen it on that morning. I'm not seeing the variance calculation today, yeah. But then the pth moment bound will come into play. You have to have a pth moment bound. Even here, you had a third moment bound. Like you needed the third moment. See here, this business. So you needed the third moment even for the bias. So you need some other moment for the variance. I don't know which one. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, honestly, I have not been able to make good sense out of this because it's the same estimate, it's not a new thing. You see, this estimate I brought up yesterday, and for this estimate I can do Taylor expansion and get the delta square and 1 by delta square kind of oracle. It went up. Now the thing is, if I do that, I won't be able to show the rate. I wanted to show at least the rate so that you know, you see that something is better here. Okay, so it's the same algorithm. I'm gonna quickly sketch something from this. See, the thing is, the initial passage will be the same. What changes is, instead of having C1 delta square, I'll have C1 delta. And in the variance, I had C2 by delta square. I'll replace it with C2 delta square plus some other C2 tilde. Okay. So, what? No, they just gave these estimates. I've seen it. They gave conditions where you can get this. But this bias variance trade-off business came up in this Nesterov paper, Nesterov, and he has not cited Kartkonik, so he has reinvented it. Yeah. So Kartkonik, Kulchitsky say that, okay, if you want to convolve with something, that thing that you want to convolve, that candidate should satisfy condition 1, 2, 3. Okay. Those three conditions are satisfied by a Gaussian density, but there could be other candidates. Yeah. You could convolve with other candidates. In fact, from my PhD times, if I recall, I think you can convolve with something and get back SPSA. can't remember the exact bit. Okay, there is some connection there, but I can't fully recall. Rademacher. I think there's a way to get to Rademacher using the convolution route. I don't recall the details. And you can even convolve with Cauchy, but clipped. I don't think you can have unbounded. So if you clip a Cauchy distribution and convolve, you'll get back some. You can still get that. So one of my PhD papers was just to have Cauchy smooth functional thing. But then this didn't happen. This was before Nesterov did something. Yeah, so I don't know which is the best distribution to convolve with, but but the thing is with the Gaussian density already you get good rates. You get like 1 by square root n rates. I don't think you can get better than 1 by square root n. Maybe you can make constants better. I don't know. See, this passage is exactly like before. I'm going to get to an intermediate point. Okay, and I write down the rest of the business. See, these terms look the same as before, except that I had a delta k square before. To some bound on the gradient plus L times summation comma k square by comma k. See, this is where the change happened. See, previously I had, I can't go there. Okay. Previously I had C1 square delta k power 4. Okay. And it became C1 square delta k square. It's the same technique. It's exact same thing. You just have to repeat the same steps and replace whatever bias variance trade-off I had there, C1 delta square and C2 by delta square. Replace it by C1 delta and C2 delta square plus C2 tilde. That's all you have to do. And you'll get this bound. Okay. And now the point is, if you see in this, the last term, there's no delta in the denominator. So you can choose delta more in a more relaxed fashion and get a 1 by square root n rate. That's really, so I'm going to just specify what delta to choose. This is theorem 8. Okay. Now set gamma k equals gamma equals there's a minimum business, you would require it to be minimum of 1 by L still, 1 by L, but the other part is 1 by root d times n, 1 by square root n. I had n power 2 by 3 there, now this delta k equals delta equals 1 by d times square root n. Okay, now if you set this, then expecting square will be less than or equal to 2L of x1 minus x star. That's all it is. Yeah. So we'll get rates as SGD only. Yeah. Whereas there you had this variance trade off, so you could not get. Yeah, purely. Yes. That's all. No, I'll just write down the last term. Yeah. So I'll just write this as constant. It's painful to write out the whole constant, but some dimension dependent constant. Okay. And the thing is, yeah, if you want this to be less than equal to epsilon, then I can have n greater than equal to. Okay, let's I wrote this wrong. If n greater than or equal to some constant delta by epsilon square, then so the dimension part got better. We had d power 4 by epsilon cube. All of this 1 by, you know, inverse scaling for the variance kills the algorithm. That's the thing that killed in the previous case. Now, if you do this, you got almost SGD rate. Yeah, stochastic gradient. Almost like you're doing unbiased. Now, the point is you can follow the technique again, do for convex also. You'll get 1 by square root n. Yeah. The initial error will be forgotten faster. The other is the noise term. So that's really the deal with this. made up a few other oracles. I'll just tell you what other oracles. I made one more oracle up, and that won't cause as much problem. But I thought it's a practical thing. So I'll just tell you what the other. You can make up other. So I'll just give out a few candidate oracles, and people can start analyzing. No, it's dimension dependent. It's dimension dependent, but its dependence on dimension is better than the dependence on dimension from my previous bound for the other oracle. That's the reason why I got D here. That's correct. Now, a few other oracles to kill time. 10 minutes at least I'll kill with this few other oracles. So one of this oracle is motivated by RL. Okay. So with what I call as an estimation error. So the motivation is like this. Imagine an RL setting or an MDP setting where if you take the simplest case where you have to run multiple episodes. So here you had a box. Okay, imagine you had a box and you pass an X and you got f of X plus some noise. Okay, you could estimate. So if I pass an X, I get, you know, f of X, I can perfectly get f of X and throw in a zero mean term. But there are several problems, like in MDP, if you want to estimate, you know, like the total cost, okay, then if you run 1000 episodes, then your estimate of that parameter, which is a policy, is better. Okay, so if you tell me, if instead of this, I mean, if I want to estimate this from IID samples, okay, then what I can do is I pass this and I can say m, which is the number of samples, IID samples that I'll take of a certain function. And then I will get a f hat, and this f hat is closer to f. I mean, as I increase m, this f hat will get much closer to f, like some usual Hoeffding bound or something like that. So the point is, I will never get f of x. Instead, I can decide as an algorithm, like in an RL task, I can decide, okay, I have a certain policy and I want to do gradient descent. I want to estimate the value function, which is like a total cost. So I will tell, okay, simulate some 1000 episodes. And take an average and tell me what is your function. Now I can use that function estimate and then do the simultaneous perturbation. Okay. So the inputs to my gradient estimation logic are themselves coming from some, IID sample averages. And that sample average is controlled by me. I can tell, okay, simulate 1000 episodes or 10,000 or 500, that. So I can make up an oracle which takes this, mini batch size as a parameter. So my new oracle, okay, bias gradient oracle plus estimation error. Okay, and as before, there is a function that the environment fixes. Okay, and then you pass a x, you pass a delta, that's your gradient estimation parameter, but you also pass a m, which is like saying that I want this many mini batches. And then what you get a G, which is a function of all of these. And you are the algorithm. Okay. Okay. And now what kind of bias variance trade-off you get? You can make up if you are in the traditional world, not the Gaussian smoothing world. Then okay, in input x delta and m, this is a mini batch size. And this is your perturbation parameter. And x is x, x is the input point, okay. And output gradient estimate g of x comma xi comma 1, and x comma xi comma m, this delta is not the one, this is xi, okay. Now what does this satisfy? Expectation of g of x comma xi comma m. See, the point is the gradient estimate would depend on how well you estimated the function, which would depend on how many IID samples you took. And so if you take classic results, if the, you know, the function that you are trying to estimate is say bounded, you apply Hoeffding's bound. So then the error in expectation is like plus 1 by square root m. So I'm going to throw in that extra bit. So this is in expectation the gradient plus C1 delta square, okay, but then there will be a C2 by M, and again from, yeah. So this is the extra bit. Now the question is, you have to decide what delta to choose and what mini batch sizes to choose. The variance of the gradient estimate would not change much. Expectation of, it would be the same as before. I mean, the motivation is just recall this Hoeffding type bound. If the estimate, like if you estimate a random variable, say f hat m minus f, this is your estimate. This is, this can be shown as some constant by square root m if you used m IID samples. Okay. And this can be done using some Hoeffding bound. You just take the Hoeffding bound. Be less than equal to some 2 times exponential minus some c m epsilon square. Take this, integrate the tail, that's a positive all random variable, you will get this bound. Okay. So you will get something like this. For people who don't believe this, just pick up some concentration bound, at least the Hoeffding bound. Assuming the function that you are trying to estimate is bounded, you get this. Okay. So what happens is the estimation error in the function is like some constant by square root m that comes in here and that goes in there, and then you use this f hats to make up your gradient estimates, okay, and that will lead to that c1 delta square gradient estimation bias. Okay, now with this we could show that if you have mini batches which could which, you know, scaled like which increased asymptotically, then that, you know, that component will not have an effect and we'll get back the rate as before. Okay. So if you just have a constant mini batch, then that will cause problems. Like if you're always taking just 10 samples to evaluate or 100 or whatever number, then that estimation error will not go away. Okay. Yeah. So, or if you want to talk about this in the RSG world, the mini batches should be some order of n. So if you're going to run the algorithm for n iterations, then have a mini batch which is some constant times n, that's fine. Or something which is like k power something, mini batches, mk is like k power something, then also it's fine. You get a rate which is comparable to the oracle without estimation error. Now you can make up a, you know, a Gaussian smoothing variant where you change that c2 delta square to something else, that's also fine. We handle that. So you can have estimation error with any oracle, whether this or the Gaussian smoothing variant. This is one of the oracles that we considered. The other oracle is like you can bring in second order information. Yeah, you want to decide how well you want to estimate the function. See, the point is when you want to make up your gradient estimate, you want to use the function at some point and some other point and do this. Now, those functions itself, I mean, whatever estimate you use, for that you have to decide how many IID samples you make up. So, you want to decide that, whether you want to estimate it super well or you can still get around with approximate estimates. So, what should be the mini batch size be? This is perfectly useful in a policy gradient algorithm. If someone is not familiar, so what happens is in a RL setting, you want to optimize a policy that maximizes or minimizes some, say, imagine you're in a cost scenario that minimizes a long run cost, which is a sum of costs or discounted sum or whatever. And then what you do is you want to estimate that. So you run episodes of this MDP, which are like simulated sample paths, and then take the total cost, take a bunch of such total cost samples, and then average. Now the question is how many episodes you will make up. Yeah, because you don't know the function. So you're not in the other world where you will get the function plus a zero mean noise. Whereas you can control, yeah, you can control by increasing the mini batch size. Okay. One last oracle before we break for lunch. First gradient / Hessian information. I'm going to throw this in the old style C1 delta square by C2 by delta square version. You can make a Gaussian smoothing version also. So using that Gaussian smoothing technique, you can get second order method also. And at some point it relates to Stein's method. yeah, that's where I read. I didn't dig deeper. Yeah. I am familiar with this Taylor series expansion. I've been able to live for 5 years with papers in this area, but now I have to pick up Gaussian smoothing so that I have to do non-asymptotic bounds, because the bounds for Gaussian smoothing seem to be better for than the normal bias variance state of business. So here what you get is you still have the oracle /G/HO. Okay, this is gradient/Hessian. And somebody fixes the function. Okay, and then you pass you pass a x and a delta. Okay, that's all you pass. And this is your algorithm. And then you get two elements. You get a g and you get a h. Okay. And this G and H are your estimates of the gradient and the Hessian at the point that you requested. And both are biased because you are working in the zeroth order setting. So to make this precise, imagine, so the input is you pass an X and you have a delta. You output gradient estimate G and Hessian estimate H, and these satisfy condition that they satisfy is, I mean the other, like the gradient estimate satisfies the same thing as before. Okay, A is equal to gradient f of x plus sigma delta square. In addition, you have a biased Hessian estimate. So, expectation with respect to xi, h of x, xi equals h of x plus some other constant c1 prime delta square. So, entry wise, you are off by delta square, entry wise. Okay. And now, if you get information like this, what you can do? Yeah. That's the question. Okay. Yeah, and for this we were able to derive some finite time bounds, but for an algorithm which is almost like random stochastic gradient. Can't remember if we used anything about the variance of this. In fact, I'm not even clear how this Hessian helped. This is all we used, and we got we got bounds that are similar to the randomized stochastic gradient case. Now, see, the point is, what I am not clear about is this. When you are talking about Newton method in the deterministic case, you can show amazing benefits. Like, you can show that it converges faster, it converges to a better point, all of those. Whereas in the stochastic case, I'm not seeing the benefits. The only benefit I've seen is like, you know, when you do this asymptotic mean square error, the step size when you have to set, in the gradient case, the step size has to be set carefully to be a, if you just do normal gradient descent, if you use a step size like C by N, that constant has to be a function of the inversely proportional to some problem dependent stuff. Whereas for the Hessian, you don't get that. Okay, that's the only advantage I've seen for Hessian methods there. I've not seen any rate benefits or better constant benefits yet. So this is just, you know, some baby step in that direction. Honestly, I didn't get anything but, I think I'm pretty much done. So these are two other oracles. So all of this is in a report that I'll put it up on archive probably early next week. Yeah, all of these oracles, the bounds.